So we have four options of how we can make this model better, or how we can decrease the bias difference. That is training more, increasing the model complexity, trying a more advanced architecture, and finding better hyperparameters. And just to also show you how to train or tune hyperparameters, I would like to go with the fourth option now and tune some hyperparameters and see the result. The hyperparameter tuning I'm going to use right now is Bayes optimizer or a Bayes search, we can call it. We can also use random search, but because we have a limited amount of time and my computer is not able to train many, many different models one after another, that will take a very long time. That's why I opt for Bayes optimizer, because it is able to find better solutions faster than random optimizer. As we talked about in the lesson, when you do random optimizer or random search for your hyperparameters, it's going to randomly look at some options. And on top of that, you might need to get closer on some of the options that it found to be the best and search in that region. And that is kind of a time-consuming approach. So instead, I want to use something that will do that automatically, like Bayes optimizer. Let's set that up. I'll show you how to set it up right now. It's actually quite simple with Keras. What we're going to import is something called Keras Tuner. And I actually already have it imported here. You can import it, you can add this line, import Keras Tuner as KT. Once again, of course, all this code is in its final form. It's in the course repository. So if you want to follow along, if you want to run the program also yourself while I'm doing it, definitely go and download it. But once again, if you want to play around with it and do other things that I'm doing, wait until the end of the exercise. Wait until I show you everything and then you can go and explore more. And you're also going to get to do that during the assignment. All right. So what we're going to do, the general idea, is basically put this model in a function, and inside that, so some of these things that we want to make, or some of the things that we want to tune, are going to become variables. So let's say if I want to change the number of neurons in the first two layers, I want to tune that, then I'm going to basically change these two variables, and these variables will be determined by the tuner, and then this model is going to be created and then returned to the fit function. So let's get started. I'll just create a new cell to show that to you. What I'm going to do at first is to create a function that's going to create my model. In here, I'm going to mention the things that I want to tune. So for now, I don't know. Let's just copy and paste the whole model here, and then I will decide what I want to do. And also the model compile line is also going to be in here. And at the end, I will return the model. All right. And on top of that, I can add the variables later. Another model I'm going to have, another function that I need to have is this one. And in here, I will basically determine the ranges of what I want the hyperparameters to be. So let's say if I want to, you know, determine the number of neurons on the first layer, this is how I can do that. I basically create integer values that go from 32 to 512, and they increase by 32. I can also create another one for the same thing, call it neurons 2. Let's say this will be for the second layer. This is also the name that you're giving it to access it at the end of the this tuning step, basically. But I'll show you that in a second. Let's say if I also want to tune the learning rate, I'm giving it a name. Let's call it something a bit more descriptive. It goes from the minimum value to the maximum value, and the sampling is going to be on the log scale. As I mentioned in the lesson, we don't want to randomly sample from a linear scale. We want the scale to be log, so it goes, so the distance, so the same amount of values will be sampled in between 0.001 and 0.01 and 0.01 and 0.1, for example. All right. And once I've done that, once I've decided, you know, what values to look at, I will basically, I'll change the name of this function, call this function that is here, and I'm going to pass the variables that I wanted to have. So I'll also write it here, neurons 1, neurons 2, and the learning rates. And how I'm going to mention them here is here, instead of 300, I'm just going to say neurons 1 is going to be the number of neurons here. And also for the second one, neurons 2. As I said, you can always have the same amount of neurons in all of your layers, but in this one, I'm basically, my main goal is to show you how this works. So that's why I'm not making it super complicated. Just seeing, you know, maybe if we'll be able to come up with a better number of neurons for the first two layers. With the learning rates, a little bit different. So basically, right now I am creating or specifying the optimizer using its string identifier, but I can also pass it the Keras variable that has the stochastic gradient descent or gradient descent with momentum. And how to do that? It's basically like this. It's like this. It's called Keras Optimizers Stochastic, well, S gradient descent. It's not really stochastic gradient descent. We're doing batch gradient descent. And then inside here, I will specify the learning rate as LR, which is the variable that is passed to me from the tuner. And that's basically it. So for now, I will only optimize or only tune the learning rate and the first two, the number of neurons in the first two hidden layers, and, you know, see if that's going to be able to give me a good model. As I said, I will be using Bayesian optimization. So this is how you create a tuner. What you do is you call the build model function. I need to pass it a HP. And then this is kind of like the hyperparameter tuner, basically. And then I am deciding what to compare the created models with, and I want them to be compared based on dilatation loss. I want 10 values to be tried, and override true is, this is something kind of like a background thing. You need to, so basically every time you create a model, Keras keeps it somewhere to kind of call it again if you want to run it again, instead of like running it from the beginning. So if you don't have that, then after a while it's going to start giving you errors about like how you already have a network running, or, you know, there are some conflicts between the two versions. So that's why I'm using override true here. And the last thing that I am going to do is to run the tuner. So here, as you realize, we don't run the model fit function like we do here. Instead, we are just going to run the tuner. I'm going to tuner search, pass it basically the same things that we do in the fit function. The validation data, epochs, x-train, y-train. I will also specify the batch size. All right, and then after it's done, I will also save the best model to this variable called best model. And this is going to take a while, of course, so but I will also make the epochs 10. 5 epochs might not be enough to really see the actual potential of a model. So yeah, let's run these and then see if it will be able to capture a good value for me. Our tuner is done now. It tried 10 different combinations of hyperparameters that we've asked it to, and it ran everything for 10 epochs. So let's get the best one and see what the values were. Yeah, I made this learning rate. All right, so it looks like the first hidden layer, the best value was to have 32 neurons, and for the second one, it was 320 neurons, and the best learning rate came down to 0.01, which is surprising, it's quite high. But, you know, so that's the tricky thing. We are training every single network here for 10 epochs, right? And if you have a high learning rate at the beginning, at the first part of your training, you're going to make really quick progress towards the optimum or the minimum cost. So that's why maybe this learning rate was able to become like or create the best model among all the other, all the 10 models. So, okay, this is what the network looks like now, 32 and 320 neurons in the first and the second one. But I also want to train this model for a longer time and see what the performance is going to be and if it's going to be a little bit better than the performance that we caught without training these or without tuning these parameters. So here I'm just going to change model to best model. And I'm going to train this model for 60 more epochs and then do the same things as looking at the graph and calculating the test performance, the test accuracy, and see how it does. So let's train this one. I trained the best model that we found in the hyperparameter tuning with Bayes optimizer here. Where is it? Yes, optimization. 60 more epochs, because at first we only ran it for 10 epochs. I ran it for 60 more. And we definitely got a little bit better from the beginning. At first we were getting around 0.3 accuracy, and now we're getting 0.38. Now if you look at the graph of it, it looks like we are making steady progress. So this looks to me like we need to train this model a little bit longer. Here was the performance from the test set that we were getting before doing hyperparameter tuning. So I will check how the best model from the tuning is doing. It's not quite capturing the performance that we were able to achieve before. But, you know, we are only trying 10 different possibilities. And as we specified here, 10 different combinations, and we are not really training a lot of different things. So for example, one thing you can do is to change all the neurons, the number of neurons, into variables or things that can be tuned. I think that could really help. And maybe instead of tuning the learning rate, we can use power scheduling for our learning rate instead of the tuning itself. So after we tune the hyperparameters, then maybe we can use scheduling for the learning rate. That might work better. Thank you.